Hi, this is Remembering the Past, the show where we talk about people who've died recently who've had a profound effect on our history, our society, or our culture. Tonight we're going to start out with our feature, one of the great actors of the 1960s, Omar Sharif. Omar Sharif died recently at the age of 83. He was a nice Egyptian boy born in Alexandria as Michel Dimitri Shalhoub, and he was in three of the top movies of the 1960s. He made his debut and his reputation in 1962 opposite Peter O'Toole in Lawrence of Arabia. You can check our podcast on Peter O'Toole. He makes one of the great entrances in movie history. You originally see him only as a speck on the horizon in the desert. And as he comes closer and closer to Peter O'Toole, you finally make out that it's Omar Sharif. He was also in Dr. Zhivago opposite Julie Christie, and then opposite Barbra Streisand as Nicky Arnstein in the movie version of Funny Girl. He continued to make movies after that, although even he admitted that none of his movies were as good as those three. But he later went on to become one of the top contract bridge players in the world, and since I'm a sort of an amateur contract bridge player, I can tell you that he was great. He wasn't a champion, but for a while he was in the top 50, and he wrote a wonderful bridge column for the Chicago Tribune here for many years. He could definitely play with the top champions in the world. Here's the BBC on the death of Omar Sharif.
The Egyptian actor and star of Dr. Zhivago, Omar Sharif, has died of a heart attack. He was 83. Celebrated as a screen heartthrob, he was also a world-class bridge player and said the game was his first love. Omar Sharif came to international prominence in the 1962 blockbuster Lawrence of Arabia, in which he appeared with Peter O'Toole.
A man can be whatever he wants, you said.
I'm sorry. I thought it was true.
You proved it.
Look, Ali. Look. That's me. What color is it? That's me. And there's nothing I can do about it.
A man can do whatever he wants. You said.
He was nominated for Best Supporting Actor in 1963 for that role. He lost to Ed Begley in Sweet Bird of Youth, although personally I would have given it to Victor Buono for Whatever Happened to Baby Jane, but that's neither here nor there. But it's very interesting how Omar Sharif got the role in Lawrence of Arabia. And here he talks about it on an episode of Desert Island Discs.
My family moved to Cairo when I was 4 years old. And I went to an English school in Cairo. In those days, Egypt was a protectorate.
Yes.
And we had very good public schools, like English public schools, even more British than the real thing. Because, you know, in the colonies, everything was exaggeratedly British. I applied to come to England and audition for RADA, Academy of Dramatic Arts. And just 15 days before I was supposed to come over, I met a friend of mine who had become by then a director, film director. He had studied in America, and I was having a cup of tea at Groppi's, which is a famous tea place in Cairo. And he walked in and he said, "I hear you're leaving to study acting," he said, "and I've got this film that I'm going to start. Would you like to test for the leading part?" And I said yes, and I did, and I got the part. David Lean, the director, wanted someone who looked absolutely genuine, who would not appear to be a disguised European. Mm. And he wanted someone with dark eyes to contrast with Peter O'Toole's light blue eyes. And they had found nobody satisfactory, and at the last moment, Sam Spiegel, the producer, had signed up an actor without telling David Lean and sent him out to the desert. And the moment he got off the plane, Lean said, "That's no good, he's got green eyes, we can't have that." And they were pretty desperate. So as a last resort, David Lean asked his assistants to find him photographs of all the existing Arab actors. And they produced about 1,500 photographs. And he went through all these photographs, and by a miracle for me, he stopped upon mine and said, "This one, go and see if he speaks any English, and if he does, send him out to the desert." "You are mad. To come to Aqaba by land, we should have to cross the Nefud desert."
"That's right.
The Nefud cannot be crossed."
"I'll cross it if you will."
"You? It takes more than a compass, Englishman. The Nefud is the worst place God created."
"I can't answer for the place, only for myself. 50 men."
"50? Against Aqaba?"
Here's Here's a little bit of him in 1965's Dr. Zhivago. He was awfully good in that, too.
Are you the poet? Yes. I used to admire your poetry.
Thank you.
I shouldn't admire it now. I should find it absurdly personal. Don't you agree? Feelings, insights, affections, it's suddenly trivial now. You don't agree. You're wrong. The personal life is dead in Russia. History has killed it. I can see how you might hate me.
I hate everything you say, but not enough to kill you for it.
Here's Lara's theme from the movie. They were playing this in another famous 60s scene when he was walking through the snowbound house with Julie Christie. At that time, I think Julie Christie was the most beautiful actress in the world. And at the end of the scene, he gives his balalaika to her as she rides off. In the highest grossing film in 1968, Funny Girl, with everyone's favorite diva, Barbra Streisand. And this is where she started out, not only with her acting chops, but with her diva chops. She made everybody's life on the set a little difficult. Omar Sharif had an especially hard time because he's playing a Jew and he kissed a Jewish girl, and this is right in the middle of the Six-Day War in 1967. He's catching grief from Egypt. They wanted to kick him off the set. William Wyler stood up for him and kept him on. Then he and Barbra Streisand have an off-screen affair, which pretty much breaks up her marriage to Elliot Gould. Don't ask. In my opinion, the back-screen drama was even better than the movie.
You.
Huh?
Are woman. I am man. You are smaller, so I can be taller than. You are softer to the touch. It's a feeling I like feeling very much. I like to feel free.
You can get lonesome being that free.
You can get lonesome being that busy.
Now, who would think to look at us that we got the same problem?
People who need people are the luckiest people in the world.
Yeah, that's Babs and Omar Sharif. Well, as long as we're talking about divas, we're going to move on now to Michael Masser, who died at the age of 74, a nice Chicago boy. He went to the University of Illinois and became a stockbroker, but then he moved into songwriting. And he specialized in 1970s and 80s direct that was very popular for two of our great divas of that era, Diana Ross and Whitney Houston. He wrote this one in 1973. It revitalized Diana Ross's single career, was number one for a long time.
Touch me in the morning. Then just walk away. We don't have tomorrow, but we had yesterday.
Berry Gordy got him to mix 79 versions of that. Oy. Then Berry Gordy had him teamed with Gerry Goffin, who burned out after he got divorced from Carole King, but he was on the West Coast and he was revitalized, and they wrote the theme from Mahogany for Diana Ross, and that was a number one. I didn't mention this in our Gerry Goffin podcast. I thought I could avoid it, but apparently not.
Do you know where you're going to? Do you like the things that life is showing you? Where are you going to? Do you know? Do you get what you're hoping for? When you look behind you, there's no open doors. What are you hoping for?
A little while after that, Michael Masser got hooked up with Whitney Houston through Teddy Pendergrass. And he and Gerry Goffin penned this one for her. It was a huge hit. They were just printing money with this stuff.
Though I try to resist being last on your list. But no other man.
remember back in the 60s, Gerry Goffin didn't want to write bubblegum with Carole King, so he goes out to L.A. to write this kind of stuff. Michael Masser wrote a couple other big songs for Whitney Houston. I think the best thing he ever did was with Gerry Goffin for Roberta Flack and Peabo Bryson.
Now I celebrate my love. It seems the natural thing to do. Tonight, no one's gonna find us. We'll leave the world behind us.
I know a lot of you 70s people like Michael Masser's music, but I just gotta move on. And we'll move on to Roger Rees, who died recently at the age of 71, versatile actor on television and on Broadway. He's best known for playing the rich twit on Cheers, Robin Colcord, and for his great performance as Nicholas Nickleby on Broadway. Here's USA Today on the nice Welsh boy from Aberystwyth, Roger Rees.
Cheers star Roger Rees has passed away at the age of 71. The Welsh-born actor has a long resume, including roles in movies.
I challenge you to a duel.
On television.
I am back, and I believe there are many more people in the room.
Excellent introducing, Your Lordship.
And Broadway. He also won a Tony for his role in the 1982 Royal Shakespeare Company's production of The Life and Adventure of Nicholas Nickleby.
One of them was
Mr. Nickleby.
Here he is in a famous scene from Cheers where he brings his own shredder with his briefcase.
He's just marrying you to shut you up so he can take over the corporation.
Yes, the gift to her is a wedding present, and now you've spoiled the surprise, Happy.
I don't believe you. Honey, listen, you got the evidence in your hand right here. If somebody comes out and sees this, you're going to be guilty, too.
Yes, well, then we must make sure that no one sees it.
Boy, you really come prepared, don't you?
And here he is telling a great story about when he played Hamlet at Stratford-on-Avon.
Arguably, the most famous words in the English language, to be or not to be, that is the question, are made the more difficult for the actor playing Hamlet because they're preceded by an entrance onto the stage. You may not know this, but just to come on stage is really, really difficult. And it's hard enough to come on stage and then have to say the most famous words in the English language straight off. I was playing Hamlet one afternoon at Stratford-upon-Avon at the matinee, and I entered from the wing. I found the lights in the middle of the stage. The audience were hushed with anticipation. They knew what I was going to say. I raised my head and they watched me as I took a deep breath as they held theirs, and I said, to be or not to be? And a woman in row G yelled out, that is the question. Yes, that is
a Roger Rees. Well, I'm going to close on that note. I want to thank my producer and IT genius, Sid Tepps. And we're going to close tonight with Roy C. Bennett, who died recently at the age of 97. Roy C. Bennett was a nice Jewish boy from Brooklyn who was born Israel Brodsky. And he teamed up with Sid Tepper as a moderately popular songwriting team of the 40s, 50s, and 60s. Frankly, they wrote a lot of junk. They wrote stuff like Naughty Lady or Shady Lane. And they wrote a bunch of the lesser songs for Elvis Presley movies. When you're talking about lesser songs for Elvis movies, you're talking about some junk. But in 1948, Roy C. Bennett, the C didn't stand for anything, and Sid Tepper wrote one of the most popular songs of the mid-century. It was recorded by everyone from Dean Martin to Al Martino to Andy Williams. It was one of Wayne Newton's most popular songs. But I'm going to play my favorite version from 1965 by the German instrumentalist Bert Kempfert. Bert Kempfert, by the way, was one of the only guys who arranged for both Elvis and the Beatles. Bert's recording of Red Roses for a Blue Lady was an instrumental, no words. You can go to Wayne Newton if you want to hear the words. So in tribute to Roy C. Bennett, here's Bert. Bert is cool.